again. Okay, really loud applause. So you're getting that. It's not difficult. It's absolutely not difficult. It's algebraic. It's kind of annoying quite often. And you can see we already have a few lines of algebra here, including the special case of that second object being initially at rest. If the two objects are both initially in motion, it's a lot more work to get out some solutions to this. But it's possible, okay, which is tedious. All right. So you have gotten the hang of this very nicely. Let's see if I can give you a couple of other semi-quantitative demonstrations. Not so great, but let's try it anyway. These two have got one object that is three times the mass of another. So, if I took the more massive object times mass, kept that stationary, so this is object B in this analysis, and I use object A with a mass that's one third of this. You don't need to do the algebra exactly, but roughly speaking, what you expect is likely to happen if I shoot this object into a stationary object, which is quite a bit more massive.
The velocity of the moving object will be negative and a lot faster.
Okay, let's see what it looks like. You ready? Wow, this is being filled. Here we go. Massive object and a stationary, relatively lighter object. Qualitatively, what's going to happen?
The heavier mass will go in the opposite direction and the smaller magnitude, the smaller mass, I
guess? The other suggestions, yeah.
If you go in the same direction, the letter was obviously going to be attacked.
Okay. So, your last chance to clap for a while. Some time ago, problem solving strategy. what we're going to do is recognize that we need now to apply the method of conservation and possibly energy conservation, depending on the scenarios. We're going to apply momentum conservation in more than one direction. We're going to apply them in perpendicular directions, as we've done with every sort of aspect of 2 or 3D motion so far. So it's not difficult, but again, the algebra is kind of increasingly tedious. At this point, all we're going to do is apply momentum conservation successively in X and Y. So momentum conservation in X and in Y. So this means that delta P in the X direction, this is for the system as a whole, so I need to add all of these together. So delta PX for the system equals 0, delta PY for the system equals 0. Okay, and I apologize if I'm scrambling here, it's because I at least want to get to the punchline of this. But I'm hoping that, you know, from sort of seeing that we constantly do this with components in X and Y, it's fairly straightforward. One thing to mention here, you are going to need to be careful about the signs, by which I mean the SRTN signs, trig signs. You do need to be careful about the signs here and make sure, for example, in the y direction, that the, for example, the y component of the momentum after the interaction is negative, right? And you've chosen plus y upwards. So you are going to need to take careful account of the signs. Once you've done it, you've got your simultaneous equations, and as before, it's a little more complicated now because we're in 2D. You're going to solve your simultaneous equation. And, in principle, of course, at least in this case, you might imagine that we've got the elastic kinetic energy of everything in the system is also concerned. So what you'll see in my notes, and also in the textbook, are a couple of pages of tedious algebra, but it allows us to extract the final velocities if we know the final angles. So again, nothing really new there, but I just want you to kind of work through it at least one side of the textbook or one of my notes and figure out how that problem works. Okay, that's it. Before you guys leave, if you're interested in free lunch, sign up here.